Welcome to the roundtable, A Promise is a Promise, National Cinematheque Now for Peru and Argentina. My name is Valeria Dávila. I am an audiovisual archivist from Argentina, and I will be moderating the roundtable today. Thank you so much, Violeta, for being here, and Mariana for sending her pre-recorded answers. And for Lorena, who is translating us today, and all the attendees joining us from the Netherlands and from the rest of the world remotely. So before we get started, I'd like to explain a little bit why it is important to have this conversation today and at this symposium. It is public knowledge what happened to the Brazilian Cinematheque during the pandemic. I mean, the closure and dismissal of its entire staff, but perhaps less known is the serious situation of the National Cinematheque in Peru and Argentina. Each of these countries, Peru, Argentina, and Brazil, represents, in a way, a different stage in the process of creating a cinematheque. Peru is in its initial stage, advocating for the creation of the cinematheque by law. Brazil has been enjoying of its cinematheque for 76 years now. And Argentina is somewhere in between, with a cinematheque that exists in law but has not yet materialized in reality. So it is critical to discuss the urgency of national cinematheques in Latin America and the consequences of not having them, especially today as we celebrate the World Day for Audiovisual Heritage, and also in this conference that is very appropriately called No Time to Wait, because our audiovisual memory has already been lost and we cannot keep waiting for its preservation. So there is much to discuss about this, and it's difficult to know where to start. So we've organized the conversation around the three themes of the symposium this year, which are transparency, teaching, and trust. But before we start, we need some introductions. So I will introduce Mariana. She is the coordinator of the National Institute of Cinema and Audiovisual Arts of Argentina, and she's currently the organizing delegate for the Argentinian Cinematheque. Now, Violeta, if you would like to introduce yourself.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for having me for this invitation. I do cinema research history, no critic. And I used to be a professor, also teaching cinema in my country. And right now I am supporting the group that our dream is create the National Cinematheque, because in Peru it's a private cinematheque that is running right now by the Catholic University. More than 30 years ago they started, but our fight, our dream is that the government, the Peruvian government, support the open, create open and finance, no, give all the sources and the resources to the National Cinematheque.
Thank you, Violeta, very much for your introduction. So maybe now we can dive into the discussion. Our first topic then is transparency. So although this is not unique of our nations, something that Peru, Brazil, and Argentina share is the key role that audiovisual professionals not only play in advocating for our cinematheques, but also a lot of times in bringing clarity to opaque situations. For instance, when there is silence from the public officials or the official institutions. This was evident, at least to me, with the Cinemateca Brasileira, where not only the richest, but the most reliable information came from the collective of ex-workers through social networks. And something similar happens in Argentina and Peru, where the community in days like this uses the hashtag Cinemateca Nacional Ya, which is National Cinematheque now, to claim for another year that goes by without the Cinematheque. So with this idea of bringing transparency, I wanted to invite you, my panelists, to share a little bit more about the situation in Argentina and Peru, what has been done so far and what remains to be done. So here we will start with Mariana's response, which is video number one. If we can play that, please, Tamara.
Bueno, la CINAIM, la Cinemateca de la Imagen Nacional de la Argentina, se creó jurídicamente por ley, la ley 25.119, en el año 1999. Y se reglamentó dicha ley por el decreto 1209 en el año 2010. Desde ese entonces, la Cinemateca tuvo cuatro delegados organizadores. La cuestión es que desde ese momento no pudo empezar a funcionar administrativamente esta Cinemateca. Es que entonces hoy como delegada organizadora, la cuarta, estoy trabajando en el proceso de conformar administrativamente nuestra Cinemateca Nacional. El 27 de octubre del año pasado, como bien lo dice la ley, hay que conformar un consejo asesor conformado por 10 categorías, en la que abarca desde el Instituto de Cine hasta universidades públicas, asociaciones de actores, de directores, de productores, el Fondo Nacional de las Artes, el Museo del Cine. Todas esas categorías deben estar compuestas por diferentes instituciones o una única institución. Y para ello se debe conformar un padrón de instituciones. Y eso es lo que hicimos el 27 de octubre del año pasado. Llamar a que se conformara ese padrón, que se pudieran inscribir las instituciones interesadas en conformar este consejo asesor. El proceso que la ley nos indica es un proceso extenso para esta conformación del consejo. El primer paso fue esta inscripción al padrón de instituciones. Y en la segunda fase, que es la que nos encontramos hoy, que comenzó el 4 de julio, es que cada una de estas instituciones inscriptas en este padrón deben llamar a un concurso público para seleccionar un candidato o un representante que forme parte del Consejo Asesor. Para ello tenemos un cronograma establecido y esperamos que para abril del año que viene podamos tener conformado este Consejo Asesor y así de esta manera empezar a tener en funcionamiento administrativamente a la Cinemateca de la Argentina. El siguiente paso, luego de conformado este consejo asesor, es llamar a concurso para nombrar a los directivos, ya sea al director ejecutivo o directora, y al vicepresidente administrativo. Eso se deberá hacer por concurso público, y esos 5 candidatos que van a seleccionar el Consejo Asesor, serán elevados al presidente, quien elegirá quienes formarán parte tanto de la dirección como de la vicepresidencia. Mi rol fundamental es que se conforme ese consejo para que la CINAIM, la Cinemateca Nacional, comience a funcionar desde la administración, comience a tener personería jurídica, ya que la CINAIM es un organismo descentralizado, autárquico, autónomo, que está bajo la órbita del Ministerio de Cultura, pero hoy no tiene personería jurídica, no tiene sede, Solo está creada, como les dije al comienzo, legalmente a través de esta ley y de este decreto reglamentario, pero no administrativamente. Bueno, esa es la senda en que nos encontramos y esperamos poder que el año que viene, el 27 de octubre, volver a tener esta charla con una cinemateca constituida.
On this day last year, the collective for the Peruvian Cinematheque was presenting the law project for the creation of the National Cinematheque. So using this image as a trigger, why is the National Cinematheque so urgent in Peru? And how did you all decide to form this collective?
Our situation in Peru is so dramatic. Because it's not that in Peru there is no money to create, to support a national cinematheque. Like all the countries in Latin America and the whole America, there is a bunch of money, but the money goes to the pockets of our politicians and not to afford to support to solve people's problem. They don't care about, they are so scared about the word culture, you know, nothing, because that's dangerous for them. So, but our materials, our memories, because that is true that in Peru, we didn't have a cinema industry like Mexico or Argentina or Brazil. However, we have a tradition to make newsreels, and we have more or less 200 features that since the cinema get in Peru in 1897, the Peruvian filmmakers did. And because we don't have a support from the government and fight with the distributors and the owners of the cinema theaters with the filmmakers didn't have support in the early years on the 19th century. They made a bunch, but a bunch, I use this word, a bunch of news reels. You know, I can say that at least in all 70 years, more or less, they made one newsreel a week, Peruvian, with Peruvian news, you know, from Lima, the capital, and from the rest of the country too, okay? So why we decide, this is the last year we start this, because it's not something new that we are fighting for. Create a national cinematheque. As I told you, there is a private one, okay? It's because in Peru, there is a government office that for cinema development. But this office doesn't care, and will not care about the film's memory, preservation. Nothing. They don't care. That's the truth. The bureaucracy all the time says, no, it can be possible. It can be possible. There is no money. And we know that this is not true. Okay. So every single day we lost materials, not in acetato, nitrate, digitals. No, everything is, we are losing right now. Every single day, okay? So we start this one because we understand that a national cinematheque must be in the same label, an institution in the same label with the same rights, with the same obligation, everything, like the National Library, for example. Not just an office inside the culture organization. No, it must be something solid. So we start the discussion, and we finished that document around September last year, and we start to fight because, like filmmakers, we have the tradition of fight. Everything that we get from the government is doing pacific, that's the truth, but fighting every single moment. Actually, today is a demonstration outside the government office, you know, to say Cinemateca Nacional, ya. National Cinematheque, right now. We don't want to. And the problem is there is no will. We fight with the terrible bureaucracy that they telling us, no, there is no money. Actually, right now, in the government office, this office that in Spanish we call DAFO, they said, we are doing, because they offer every year at least 5 scholarships, like support 5, around $35,000 to restore films. But they don't know, they don't have idea. This year, for example, I was member of the jury of that, de ese concurso, okay? And I was so mad because there was not any organization. They don't have any single idea what the preservation means, okay? And there is not a politics, you know, something that, okay, you wanna do this, you have to do this, nothing. And when we express our discomfort, you know, when we says, no, stop and let's talk, the government and we, the filmmakers, that we wanna do that, they turn around and says, we cannot do it, there is not money, there is not this one. So the bureaucracy is our worst enemy, okay? Always, they are our worst enemy. So even the Peruvian cinema in his history, we get some important prizes around the world, okay? But they don't care. But I think the government didn't notice, these bureaucracies didn't notice that we are filmmakers and we are going to fight with our life if this is necessary to get the national, because it's not for us, it's for the future, okay? It's not right now. We have to understand that preservation, the same, we have Machu Picchu, we have thousands of rings, we have bases. Well, the cinema, future documentaries or whatever it is not for us. It's part of our identity, okay? And that must be preserved for the future generations, to know how we were and how we are right now. And the people support us because we try to spread what we are going to do today in Lima, and people that even we don't know support us, because when we show some materials that we found, people are so excited, so happy. They start to get memories. Yeah, this was my street, so it's wonderful, but nothing. And all the bureaucracy, when there is a camera in front of them, they talk, yes, we are going to support, we are going to do this, we are la 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 la. Then when the camera turn off, no, we were asking for meetings with them, asking new letters all the time, like, you know, every day. Up today, nothing. Today, I hope it's going to be a big fight, because we asked to the newspapers, TV, not to come to support us, all right? And we hope at least, because they want to make first the building, then they wanna buy the machines that is necessary to for the Cinematheque, and then open. So in 10 more years, and our fight is for today. I told them a few days ago, what we need is a little space, a little room, some shelves, and then we start. They don't even know how the legendary Cinematheque starts 70 years ago or 80 years. They don't have anything. No, they wanna first build the building and everything. And we, please don't get mad, okay? I don't want to be get mad again, but that's our situation. And the pretext is there is no money. There is poor people that the government has to support. And that's not true. Peru is a rich, rich country, but the money goes to the pocket of the politicians and the bureaucracy. That's what I can tell you right now, what's going on.
Exactly. Yeah, so much of what you are telling resonates with what is happening in Argentina, and also what I've been talking to Mariana, that our law is very complex. So there's a lot of things that wasn't thought of when they wrote the law. And these kind of legal things are also like stopping, like for example, Mariana and her team to do certain things. And everything is so bureaucratic, the whole process, that it takes years and years, and it's, you know, impossible. But this, well, if I can go on with the next topic of discussion, or if you would like, I can share these fragments of Peruvian cinema.
Of course, I would love it to share with the people who are hearing us, the spot we did for the last year when we go to the government office to show what we did. It's really short. That's my city. That was the spot we did last year, because we understand that our fight is not only for the cinema, the movies we did, all right? Is commercials, is TV programs, is sound, is everything, okay? We understand that the preservation could be also posters, flyers, the clothes of the workers in the cinema theaters, everything. Of course, the most important is to start with the films, okay? With the movies, okay? Whatever. But we understand that the concept is very wide, it's open. We not only think of just movies. And that's why when we decide to do this spot, we says no. We have to show that is the football players playing. You know, it's all commercials from the TV. You know, all. So we try to put a little bit of everything. Yeah.
I love that spot, and I think it was a great idea to show some of these fragments for raising conscience about the importance of preserving these materials. Mm-hmm. And since we don't have, like, I think we have 30 more minutes, this serves well to moving on to our next topic, that is trust. So when I think of this concept, I think that what happened to me when I learned about the Cinemateca Brasileira closing during the pandemic was feeling, you know, such an important and with worldwide recognition institution like the Cinemateca Brasileira closing just like that. It left me with a feeling of fragility, you know, this sense that, okay, even when we already have our cinematheques, they can, you know, disappear just like that. And it's a little bit traumatic, and also things like this, I think, create a sense of distrust, right? And when, you know, when 20 years goes by, like it happens in Peru and Argentina, that we have this project of the Cinemateca, but we don't see that becoming a reality. I feel like it creates a strange mix of hope, because we want to still be hopeful that this is going to happen someday, but at the same time we feel, you know, low morale. We feel like distrust, disbelief that this is going to happen someday. So maybe there's no like a straight answer for this, but I'm interested in you know, what do you think about this? How we keep on going with the fight for the Cinematheque that we need so urgently, and how can we restore this trust that this, you know?
Well, it's so frustrating. Okay, that's true. It's so frustrating, but we understand we have to keep in the fight. If we slow down, that's it's more frustrated than not keep the fighting, you know, because, but we understand also right now in Peru, you know, because the news, we have a terrible government. We think that it could be worse than with the Fujimori band and everything. And you know, this is bad and the other is worse. Okay. But anyhow, you have to keep the fighting. You cannot lose where you want to reach, like the Che Guevara, hasta la victoria siempre, you know? And it's not easy. Because we are fighting in Peru, the old ones, the new generations, they don't understand so much because they live today. They don't think in the future. We try to push them to understand, you know? Okay, we need, in Peru, we need a law. Because you cannot destroy the National Library, because it was created the day after we get our independence. The National Archive, you know, National Library, and the government did other for all the government papers, okay? The two of them were created the day after we get independence in 1821 by law. So that's why we fight for a law, because a simple office can disappear. A new bureaucrat came scared because this, you know, we have examples of what happened with Chile Fins and other experience in Argentina in the dictatorship's period, you know, when everything they destroy, right? Anyhow, they can destroy. We know that, okay? But anyhow, you get like a little bit more of security protection, because if you did something against that, it's a crime. You will be punished by law, okay? So And we are filmmakers. We never lose that thing in our minds. And to be a filmmaker, you have to have the strength for fight, because be a filmmaker is the craziest thing in the world, okay? Get your movie ready, any type of movie, you have to keep doing. It could be 5 years in some cases. Since you start with the idea until you get the movie, it's 6-7 years. That happened around the world, we know that. Well, it's the same. Now, we cannot lay down our arms, okay? And we have to fight. And when we learn, and we are looking now, you have to get a politician that needs to, he wants to get reelected for the next period. That is going to help you. Probably he doesn't care, she doesn't care, or whatever, you know, but he needs to be elected the next period. Well, that people is going to support you. And now, right now, we are looking, but in our situation, the political situation in Peru, for the next Congress, nobody is going to be elected again, so nobody wants to support it. It's funny, but that's the truth, you know? And you have to be clear. That's the discussion we got 2 days, 3 days ago, when our intern discussion with the people, that I told them, no, we have to think in this way. We cannot think in another way, just this way, okay? And the rest is silent. I don't care. If the people feel offensive, it's their problems, go therapy. We need to save, to rescue everything, our history. Maybe because I write history and I understand that the movie is a document, you know, that can help you for many, many things. I try to fight in that way, right? And today we have many meetings. You know, this is my first meeting with you that I'm happy to talk, you know. Then at 12, at 2, I have other, and at 6, because we try to make, you know, scream, rah, rah, rah. And yeah, that's the only way, you know. And in the filmmakers too, around the world, you know, one thing, the other one, no, you have to say, let's do it together. If you want to do yourself, get out of here. You have to be in one way, you know, so tough, but open to come, no? To invite more people. So you have to go like two step back, you know, and 3 forward, you know, something like that, because you have to learn to negotiate too. You know, for example, the last administration in the culture office in Peru, it was a boss, the director, not the minister, the second one, he wanted to support us. He wanted and help a lot and do it everything easy for us. Perfect, okay? But he get fired, he was changed. The new one doesn't want to hear, even to hear, okay? All right, you have to find someone that is there, you know? Pushing, you know? We thought, because two of the people that right now, I did the directors of this cinema office in the government, in the Peruvian government, supposedly belong to our group, you know? And now they are in the government office and they are telling us, no, this is not possible. There is no money. And tonight is going to be a big fight. Let me tell you, and I am going to make the fight, you know? And I don't care. If you don't scream, nothing is going to happen. But we learn also because we have tradition to fight for the cinema law, we learn for each congressist, you have to be there, explain, it's time, takes us a lot of time, a lot of effort, but we do it in Peru. The only way we get our cinema law was in that way, working in that. Of course, take us many years, because it was, you know, each office, knock the doors and explain them. And even some of the congressmen or women says, but are you going to preserve porno? Because in Peru, pornographic, in Peru, we are not doing that. So you even have to explain the nonsense they have in their minds, you know, because it's terrible, but you never has to get up, you know, giving up. You never have. Otherwise, let's go to the retirement house, you know, to live happy, you know. And I am not the enthusiastic person. I am a realistic person, you know. And I know that if to the bureaucracy, you don't put a camera, nothing is going to happen. That's the truth. That's the our experience, you know.
It is. And I know all of the work that you are doing and the collective, it's so important. And I'm eager to see what happens today. So I will contact you later to see how that's going.
Sorry to interrupt you, but it's along the country. It's not just in Lima. It's going to be in Cusco, in Iquitos, that is the jungle for us. In the north of the Peru, there is some filmmakers that it's going, maybe there is not a bunch of them, but at least it's run around the country, because this time we get tired. It's now or never. That's it.
La confianza se recupera haciendo. La inacción es lo que no se debe hacer. Sé que son 22 años que tenemos o que tengo sobre la espalda. Yo soy parte de esta comunidad, así que tenemos. Pero creo que pequeños pasos, a pesar de que pequeños pasos hoy hablar, pequeños pasos después de 22 años, suena desesperanzador o que otra vez, pequeños pasos hacen a que hagamos ruido. Y yo creo que el ruido está en que nuestras voces se escuchen, en que podamos hablarlo, en las necesidades, en, como te dije antes, las políticas públicas son necesarias frente a esta problemática. Es un problema que tiene que estar en alerta en el Estado, en el gobierno. Para tener un Estado democrático tenemos que tener políticas públicas. Así que es sumamente necesario que demos pasos. Dando pasos gigantes, quizás no sé si lo lograríamos, porque quizás nos perderíamos o nos marearíamos en esta ansiedad porque esto ocurra, ¿no? Yo creo que hay una ley que hay que cumplirla, que hay una ley en la que investigué, leí, releí, hice el análisis de ella y de su decreto reglamentario, y hoy estamos dando los pasos que la ley me pide que dé. Y yo creo que si esos pasos podemos como comunidad cumplirlos, porque tenemos que estar también comprometidos en cumplir esos pasos. No es solo la responsabilidad mía como delegada organizadora, es responsabilidad de una comunidad que tiene que cumplir esos pasos. Creo que vamos a lograr que la Cinemateca se conforme y ya no como un deseo o una esperanza, sino que ocurra. La confianza la tengo yo, en que estoy poniendo todo lo que la ley me pide. Digo, la confianza está puesta en cumplir esa ley.
Okay, yeah, I do have like one more like topic of discussion to close if we like, we have just a little minutes, but so it's the topic of the importance of teaching. Teaching is the other theme of the symposium, because you know, to sustain the activities of a Cinemateque, we need trained workers that take care of the materials, and it's kind of you tell me if you think this is a myth or not, that there's this idea that we don't have, you know, a lot of prepared people because like there are not a lot of audiovisual preservation programs to study in our countries. So people who can go and study abroad and maybe they come back, maybe not. What do you think, what would you share about the landscape in this sense in Peru? Can Peruvian filmmakers and you know, people interested in doing preservation work without the visual materials study this, or do they have to learn on the job like it used to be? Can you share a little bit about that?
Yeah, in Peru, we don't have a school, a program to learn how to make preservation, you know? Some of the old ones, because the La Católica, La Filmoteca de la Católica, which is the private institution that is in Peru, they have an agreement with Mexico Filmotech, and a few of the people that is working with, they send to learn the proper way to make preservation. But it's not a bunch. There is maybe 3-4 people. There is no more, okay? And some of the youngest, young people, there is another 5-7 people that they went to Elias Querejeta or school of preservation, whatever. They make this stage or whatever. Okay, but in my opinion, okay, these new people, they don't have experience. They don't even work one day in a film archive. They know everything in theory, nothing in the ground, which is a big problem, okay? In my opinion, there is a people who is a study to be a librarian, which in Peru we have, specialty, they have to open this branch. You know, it's different. It's people with more brain that understand why you are preserving materials, okay? But we have to work. Our way is too far, you know? We have a bunch of problems, you know? And we hope little by little we can solve them. We have the hope. If you lose the hope, nothing is going to happen. That's in my experience, you know? Right now, for example, there is more people doing cinema history in Peru. 30 years ago, that when I start, there was nobody. And everybody looked at me like crazy, you know? What are you doing? What for? Why don't you write cinema critic? I said, I don't care. Right now, there is more people that is doing papers, cinema history papers in Peru. So if you do not understand, you don't teach, you don't create the protocols, you know, you don't say, we have to do this way, nothing is going to happen. It takes time. This is a human society, you know, and in the human everyday life, history, it takes time, you know, it's not like you cannot do like this, click, you know, like this, and everything is happening. You are not a genius, you know, to click your eyes and everything happen. No, takes time. And for example, in Argentina, we have to learn how other movement did, the human rights movement in Argentina. Even everything what happened, all the laws for the forgive, everything, they were there, you know, until they get it, what they want, justice. Well, we have to do the same. You know, keep going. Like the drop in the stone. Boom, boom. In one moment, something happened. And you have to be ready. That's my experience.
Argentina hoy existe la diplomatura en preservación y gestión, que si bien se da, una de las diplomaturas se da en forma privada, a través de la Sociedad del Patrimonio Audiovisual, en la que yo soy parte, estoy en el módulo de acervos audiovisuales, todo lo que tenga que ver con archivos, su gestión y cómo, desde el punto de vista archivístico, llevarlos adelante. También hoy también surgió la diplomatura en el UNA, en la Universidad Nacional de las Artes, y se proyecta que el año que viene, en la UNTREF, en la carrera de la licenciatura de producción audiovisual, haya un módulo, o una materia, perdón, de acervos audiovisuales, o de archivos audiovisuales. Y otra de las novedades, que quizás el año que viene haya un posgrado en la NARC, también sobre archivos audiovisuales. Creo que tenemos que continuar, en Córdoba también está, si bien está la carrera de la licenciatura en archivística, ahí se da parte de lo que es archivos audiovisuales. En la carrera en la UBA sobre bibliotecología, hay un módulo o una materia que es sobre archivos audiovisuales. Hay pequeños pasos que se van dando que permiten que nos vayamos profesionalizando. Yo soy técnica superior en gestión de archivos en una carrera de La Plata, en la Universidad de La Plata. Así que vamos dando pequeños pasos para poder profesionalizarnos. Lo fundamental es la corresponsabilidad, trabajar con diferentes, como gestores documentales o archivistas, debemos trabajar con otros profesionales, los licenciados en conservación, los informáticos, los historiadores. Tenemos un montón de otros actores, químicos, que debemos sumar a nuestros equipos de trabajo, y tener corresponsabilidades, interdisciplinariedad. No todo tenemos que saberlo, para eso existen otros colegas que puedan colaborar en esto de la preservación, el acceso y la gestión de nuestros archivos. Es fundamental continuar profesionalizándonos. Hoy pensamos, y creo que es una cuestión, me voy a permitir decir, en Latinoamérica, solo pensar en lo analógico. El material digital que se produce es vasto, es mucho, y también debe ser tener políticas de preservación a largo plazo, lo digital, cómo lo preservamos, dónde lo alojamos, tenemos que tener reservorios pensados en que tengan preservación digital, cómo gestionamos cómo los describimos, cómo los recuperamos. Digo, entonces tenemos que interactuar con otros especialistas más allá de lo que podamos como gestores profesionalizarnos. Tenemos un abanico grande por el que trabajar, el audiovisual, el audio, la fotografía y lo digital, que hoy abarca mucha porción, y diría que mucho más que lo analógico. Así que también tenemos que no solo trabajar con nosotros profesionales, sino que incorporar conocimientos nuevos tecnológicos quienes gestionamos, y además tenemos que pensar políticas para el todo, ¿no? Y seguir sumando conocimientos, digo, no termina solo en la Argentina, hay asociaciones, hay colegas del mundo en el que pueden compartir sus experiencias, digo, hay foros de discusiones. Lo que sí tenemos que pensar en dónde nos encontramos, en la región. Entonces, a veces, digo, tenemos muchos de los textos en inglés, no porque se desprecien, sino porque, digo, estamos en la región, tenemos que producir más textos. Tenemos que empezar a relacionarnos como región, empezar a producir como región cuestiones que con problemáticas que nos atraviesan a nosotros, y eso también nos va a permitir aprender y profesionalizarnos al mismo nivel, digo, porque estamos todo el tiempo mirando hacia lugares como Europa o hacia lugares como Estados Unidos, que son fantásticos y los celebro y tienen mucho bagaje informacional y mucha experiencia vivida y transitada, pero digo, la región tiene que seguir sustentándose para poder abordar la problemática de la misma manera, porque tenemos los mismos problemas, y ver qué soluciones llega a cada uno y que le sirva al otro. Y eso también hace que uno se capacite, profesionalice, y creo que eso es lo fundamental.
I will keep talking, you know, for hours, but I think we are, that we have to, you know, close the conversation now. But it's been such a pleasure, Violeta, and thank you for, you know, being here with such short notice. I really appreciate your presence here and having this discussion. It's so important to our audiovisual heritage. I really wish you the best of luck with everything you are going to do today. That is very important. And I'm eager to see what you accomplish.
Thank you so much for having me, for inviting me. Yes, we cross our fingers. We know it's not today, we are not going to solve the problem, but at least we are there, and we hope they give us a room, a little room to start. No wait to until they build the building, because they told us that. No, we are going to build a building. Yeah, 10 more years, you know? Nothing is stupid. They don't have brain. They don't have brain. Thank you so much. Good luck for everything. And well, here we are. Bye-bye.
Thank you both for this conversation.
Thank you.
Is there any questions? Still one question? No. Just one question, please.
Thank you so much for sharing this story. My name is Soska, ex-Polish Lubavitch, and right now Russian Lubavitch. I was wondering what general film community can do for you. Is it, do you have some expectation how we would is it something we could help also next year? There would be, if you have a congress in Mexico, so it would be closer to you. Is it something which can be done from the broader film community, the film archive community?
The question was, what can the community do to help you, the audiovisual community, preservation community?
In Peru? Nothing.
Nothing. Oh. Okay.
No, to support everything what we are doing today is money from our pockets.
Okay.
To make the flyers, to do this is our pockets, you know? And besides that, nothing. And friends that works in the media, TV, radio, whatever, that we can call them and say, come on, please come to support us. They promise us to come. We hope, because we need to be on the red carpet today, you know? And to talk with the police that don't going to punish us, you know, because more something like that. But besides any support, money, nothing at all.
Okay. Thank you so much again.
You're very welcome.
Thank you.